everybody, and welcome to the Clean Energy Track at Sankalp. Before we begin with a very insightful panel discussion, we'd like to show you a short video that showcases our five finalist enterprises that have participated in the Sankalp Awards and have emerged as finalists out of more than 30 applications. Could we have the video, please?
Close to 1 million metric tons of e-waste every year, and this industry is growing at a CAGR of 30%. Till date, the electronic and electrical waste in India is handled in the most unorganized sector.
In rural villages, there is no cost-effective public transport that provides convenience and freedom. All they need is a basic transport alternative from point A to point B. The most convenient, cost-effective way. Buildings are surrounding green, accounts for about 30% of the energy consumption. Also, it's responsible for 40% of the greenhouse gas emissions, about 45% of the raw material consumption.
The discussion today that we're going to have in the Clean Energy Track is focused on freeing energy from the grid and fostering off-grid solutions to power Asia. According to 2010 estimates, 22% of the global population does not have access to electricity. Of this, approximately 42% live in Asia. The current total penetration of grid electricity in rural areas is about 50%, leaving out every one of two people without access to electricity. Recent studies have repeatedly undermined both human and economic benefits of rural and semi-urban electrification and its strong link to poverty eradication. In this context, India and Asia have seen the rise of innovative off-grid solutions that have changed the lives of millions of people across the region. This panel today will look at the barriers of entry into the off-grid market, showcase successful enterprise solutions, and discuss ways in which private capital can be channeled towards off-grid electrification. We have a fantastic lineup of speakers today. Our moderator is Mr. Vivek Mehra, Managing Director of Allo Private Equity. Vivek, could I please ask you to come up on stage? Vivek is an experienced finance professional with several years of investment banking, corporate finance, and corporate treasury management experience. During his career, Vivek has, as an entrepreneur, built several successful businesses for large corporations in India. He has a keen interest in environment-related issues and holds an MBA from Banaras Hindu University. Our panelists today include Mr. Harish Hande, founder and managing director of Selco. Harish, could I please ask you to come up on stage? Andrew Scroter, founder of Sunlabob Renewable Energy. Andy, could I please ask you to come up? Mr. Vinay Jaju, founder of Energy Solutions. Pravan Malhotra, Cleantech Investment South Asia at the International Finance Corporation. And Mr. Ibrahim Rahman, Social Transformation Division at Terry. I would like to hand over the proceedings now to Vivek Mehra, our moderator for today.
Thank you, Deepi. How these are going about impacting lives in rural India, how these are going about bringing the rural India as well as the people there and the general countryside into the mainstream energy provision. I think it's a very bad issue. I think one of the big problems we face in India, as well as in many parts of Asia, which is why we have Andy also here today, is energy access for the rural people. There is energy problem. I think accessing energy is a problem for urban people as well. But I think today our target and this forum is to talk about how to make energy access, how to access energy, or how to make this energy available to the rural poor. And we have a very, very good panel, very enlightened panel here to take you through these, take us through this discussion. We've got Harish. Harish is well known in this area. I'll let him introduce himself, but he's established Selco, which is a successful social enterprise, which has been providing off-grid solutions to various parts of rural India. We've got Vinay here, on my left. Vinay also has been working out of Kolkata. I'll again let you introduce your enterprise. And we've got Andy. Andy brings us a slightly different perspective. I think while we are mainly here to talk about rural India, but Andy has experience in building this business in other parts of Asia, other than India. His is really a global business. He's been looking at the same problem from a global perspective. And then to support these three entrepreneurs in terms of their insights on policy and financing, we've got two experts, Hafiz, who comes from Terry, who can give us a very good insight into how the policy making is happening, particularly in India with respect to this sector. And Pravan, who's leading IFC's investments in clean tech. Pravan has a ringside view into what investors, particularly developmental investors with a developmental outlook, how do they see this sector? How do they see provision of equity to this sector? What are the challenges they face in terms of evaluating such social enterprises who are looking to scale up and who need capital for growth? I think without much ado, may I start with asking maybe Vinay to introduce yourself in a few quick lines and then move in this direction.
Sure.
And then we can jump straight into our discussion.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Vinay Jaju. I'm part of the Onergy team. We are based out of Kolkata. You can call ourselves baby Selcos. That way we'll get attention from everyone. Everyone start listening to me. Our model is to set up renewable energy centers. So focus on last mile access to energy solutions, distribution and servicing by creating an ecosystem that will promote take up of energy solutions.
Harish?
My name is Harish. I belong to an organization called Selco, which promotes small solar solutions to mainly to rural households in Karnataka. We work with mostly the rural banks in Karnataka and a little bit of Gujarat. We are 17 years old. We started in 94-95. We've served around 140,000 households, 26 offices, mostly in Karnataka. Fundamental philosophy is how do we link up sustainable energy to poverty alleviation, to remove poverty, and then how do you grow it from a need-based point of view? And we do not believe in the concept of scale-up, and nor do we believe in the concept of private equity in this field.
Good to hear. Andy, you like to?
Good afternoon. My name is Andy Schroeder. I'm originally from Germany, but living since 1995 in Laos. And Laos is still one of the 10 poorest countries in the world. And the situation here, the geographical, cultural difference to India is immense. So we're facing different problems here. We're working really with really the poorest of the poorest. We started the business in 2000, and the main idea of from our business philosophy is not selling the hardware, selling the service to the poorest of the poorest. This is the only way, and I'm happy to talk more about it later on, but this is the biggest difference, that we are not focusing on selling to individuals the hardware, where lots of cash is involved here. Our idea is more just that these people are paying for the service. Meanwhile, we expand, and this is also different to many of other different business models, that we starting really as a grassroots level company in the middle of nowhere. Meanwhile, we are active with our activities, with our projects in Cambodia and Southeast Asia, in the Pacific, and also many countries in Africa.
Well,
so I'm with IFC, which is part of the World Bank Group. We invest in the private sector with a developmental agenda. South Asia is one of our largest markets. We invest about $1 billion a year in all kinds of forms, from equity to senior debt and everything in between. Climate change in particular is one of the strategic pillars of the overall corporation and a very strong focus for us in South Asia. So we've been active in a number of different areas, from investments and an advisory program, including a Lighting Asia program that I can talk about later. And my focus beyond looking at overall climate change activities in South Asia is also leading our clean tech venture capital practice. And we've been fairly active, made 5 investments over the past 18 months, including some two in off-grid, one applied solar technologies, which is solar for telecom towers, and husk power, which is using biomass for rural electrification. So hoping to address Harish and making myself less redundant on the panel, and there is a role for private equity, I hope, which we can talk about.
Hafiz?
I'm Ibrahim Hafizur Rahman. I'm with the organization called the Energy and Resources Institute, in short TERI, which has been working for over the last three decades in the field of energy and environment. Of the several things that we do, we focus a lot on decentralized energy solutions. We have a major initiative called Lighting Billion Lives Program, where we are focusing on providing off-grid solar photovoltaic based solutions, but we focus on the three critical aspects. One, of course, is looking at technology innovation and development. Second, on seeing that how you can have or experimenting with different business models. And third, of course, finding the connect between grassroots implementation with policy and regulatory issues. We have been, energy access has been one of the key areas for us. We've been focusing on all three aspects of energy access, and both our initiatives on lighting and cooking is basically in that direction.
Thank you very much. Harish, I think it's good and customary to start from you. You've been probably the longest in this sector. Amongst all the entrepreneurs, I don't really know about how long Andy's been in it, but you said 17 years, so that sounds like a long enough time to question you. I think I don't want you to count all the 17 years, but if you go back to the last couple of years, how do you see the sector developing? Where do you see are the big challenges? Where do you see have been your big challenges in terms of permeating your products, your services into the countryside?
If you look at, the thing is, I would say what's happening in the last 2 years. I would say I was very lucky to have started this in the early 90s, where you had less number of workshops and conferences. You could actually spend time building a business,
right,
and not worry about PowerPoint presentations, right? On a serious note, people, but I feel the youngsters are spending more time jumping from workshop rather than hard put their hands dirty. And that's the barrier of us scaling up or replicating our business is, mm-hmm. I really don't have youngsters who are operationally experienced. Mm-hmm. They're good in PowerPoint presentation, but you ask a critical question about the interest rate or how do you develop a service center in a rural area, working with a rural bank, with the local panchayat, they're lost. Mm-hmm. And I think that is, if you look at the, I've seen energies also, issues are, how do you create appropriate number of youngsters who can actually spend some time operationally learning what's happening in the ground? Mm-hmm. If you look at our 17 years of journey, unfortunately or fortunately, after our turnover of people is 1.5%. Mm-hmm. Okay, so we have a lot of people from the early 90s to mid 2000 who have joined us. But the quality of people who have joined us in the last 3-4 years have been completely on a passion. But quality of people that we have rejected is because the more you pay, less they want to go into the rural areas.
Well, that's a very interesting perspective, that you have started by bashing youngsters rather than bashing the government, which I always hear. That the government does not give the right kind of support to businesses such as you.
There are barriers on the other ecosystem that's barrier to any other business. That's mm-hmm. an easier challenge to overcome. Like, overcome. Mm-hmm. But it's the youngsters that I have a feel that I have a problem with now coming up, spending more time in the field. And I see that lacking. And that's a challenge for many. Even if you look at any of the funds that are coming up, the issue is actual deal flows. Mm-hmm. Why are the actual deal flows not happening? Because many of the youngsters are not grounded in on creating a social enterprise. Once I see a youngster not spending, suppose in our sector, off-grid, if somebody has not spent 2 years in the rural area, I'm very hesitant that he or she will be able to build a business. Mm-hmm. He should know what a panipuri vendor wants, he should know what a paddy farmer wants, he should know what a sugarcane farmer wants. What's the difference between a tomato vendor and a potato vendor? I need those answers from that. If he does not know all these integrities, how is he going to create a business? And that's for me is the biggest challenge.
The big challenge of scaling up your
business. And I'm seeing that challenge actually increasing. And the second challenge is the ecosystem that we have created here, it's all for English speakers.
Mm-hmm.
How do we create an ecosystem for non-English speaker? Where, how many of us would go and invest equity investment into a non-English speaking entrepreneur? He needs to have a degree from IIT or IIM or Stanford. Oh, that's good, great, right?
In protecting my community, I would say very difficult to convert some of these shareholder agreements to MB. Probably we will understand them.
But if you look at the sustainability of this country, the Green Revolution, the India became sufficient in food supply because of non-English speaking entrepreneurs. Mm-hmm. Did not happen because of English speaking entrepreneurs.
Right.
That's so far. I think we need to create an ecosystem. How many of us actually go and speak to an Hindi speaking entrepreneur who can actually develop social business? None of us. There's not a single case study. How many of us actually do an equity investment into a how many of non-English speakers can actually you go and give a direct grant? He's a recipient of a grant. He's not a manager. I think these are two challenges for the social enterprises, and that's a challenge for us.
Very interesting. Very different answer to what I'd expected. Vinay, would you agree with what you hear, or are there parts of your problem which are not what Harish has faced or different from what Harish has faced? What would you say?
Sure. So I'm usually on the other side listening to Harish, and I have this big smile on my face, and I can't hide that smile right now as I speak. But right, so taking point from Harish, it is a big challenge when we are trying to grow our team, and we want a team that is as passionate. Because if anyone asks me now, what is the biggest challenge you have? I don't say it's money. I don't say it's government. I just say it's the team I have to build. It's the team. It's the processes that I have to build that my team will follow. That's the one straight answer, and I don't think anyone else has an answer for it. It's ourselves, because right, we've been in that. Space where we're jumping from workshop to workshop, IIT to IIM, talking to young people. But so they get very motivated, but I don't know if that inspiration remains where they can come out and speak. Like speaking of myself, I don't know if I have answers to Harish, but of what a tomato vendor wants or what a potato vendor wants. I don't spend as much time in the field as I would like to. So there are serious problems around that. And the other thing that I feel that young people sort of have are these misconceptions. I think the way they're taught, the education they get, they sort of, it just corrupts the way they think. Like taking my case, I thought if I want to serve the rural people, they are poor people, I have to give poor products to them. By poor products, cheap products that I can sell to them. And that's what a typical young person reading some case studies or listening to some professor, or I don't know who, I don't want to bad name anyone, everyone's well-meaning, wanting to do the right things. But I went into the field with talking about products that they can afford, a 600 rupee lamp. How can I sell a 600 rupee solar lamp? And people came back to us and said, we don't want this. Would you use this in your home, in your city? Why can't I deserve more? Why can't I run my TVs and fans? And that made me angry, really. To be honest, that made me angry. Like, boss, you don't have money, cab. What are you asking for more? Just be happy with what you have. And then I came back, started thinking, got connected with people who understand the space, who've built the thing. We're getting incubation from Selco, and that sort of, and also the experiences in the field have sort of helped us understand the entire space, understand to look at how we can respect the people, how can we use energy solutions to really find answers to what people aspire for. There's also something, of course there are challenges with the government, of course there are challenges raising investment in this space. You need to be extremely, extremely patient. I was just sharing earlier, we have to, like some of the leads, some of the banks, some of the rural institutes we've been following up for the last 1 year, they finally come through, some of them this month. So that's the kind of patience you require. I don't know how many young people have that kind of patience. I don't know if the government has that patience. I don't know if the investors have that kind of patience, but that is what's required in the field. And those are some of the experiences maybe I can share from...
Can I pick up on one of the things you said? I mean, let's come back to the issue of the problems in terms of scaling up, which are people-focused issues. But coming back to the issue of product, you did mention that you have experimented with products and you found people wanting more.
Right.
The second challenge you face with introducing products into the market has been affordability.
Right.
We've all heard of the need for financial institutions. Particularly, there's been a lot of talk about microfinance entering and supporting the purchase of these things and has not been successful.
Correct.
What are your experiences in that area? Are there any solutions emerging? Do you see affordability going up, do you see product design improving? How are you working around these two issues? Are you bringing in better designs? Are you bringing in some global expertise to work in this area before I turn to Andy on this? Can you share your experiences, both of you? Harish,
okay.
You want to begin?
See, the question of affordability at the doorstep of a poor person is a combination of technology, finance, market linkages. When we talk about affordability, we jump to the conclusion that it's the cost of the product.
Mm-hmm.
A very cheap product with expensive financing is an expensive product.
Right.
A expensive product with cheap financing is an affordable product.
Mm-hmm.
So it's the way you look at it. And microfinance is actually not the key. Because if you look at many of the poor who buy solar lighting systems, for them it's an asset.
Mm-hmm.
It's the second most expensive after the house itself.
Mm-hmm.
You and me will not buy an asset on a credit card.
Right.
And microfinance is a kind of a credit card. If you short-term, they're not asset-based financing.
Right.
You need to have longer-term financing. You need 3 years, 5 years.
Mm-hmm.
That matches the cash flow of the end user.
Mm-hmm.
And that's exactly, if you look at the expenditure of the poor, as you go deeper into the economic strata, the cost of energy actually increases for the poor.
Mm-hmm.
And per month or per day, what they pay, if you actually do that over a period of 5 years,
earnings.
Yeah. If you act like a street vendor spends 15 rupees on a daily basis for kerosene,
mm-hmm.
450 rupees a month, that's equivalent to a 6-light solar system,
mm-hmm.
if financed over 5 years.
Mm-hmm.
So it's a question of how do you look at the cash flow, look at from other point of view what the cash flow is, create a product that actually matches that cash flow, and you'll see that many of the solar lighting systems in fact match the cash flow of the India, we have a bunch of clients who total earnings is 1600 rupees a month.
Mm-hmm.
They spend 140 rupees on kerosene and candles. They spend 40 rupees on mobile charging because the landlord might call them anytime. 180 rupees, 200 rupees, take it for 2400 rupees a year, 10,000 rupees in 5 years.
Right.
A solar system with two light systems and one mobile charging is 7,500, include interest 8,500 rupees.
Mm-hmm.
So what do you call it as affordability? If I go and say it's an 8,000 rupee product, or she's only earning 1,600 rupees, oh, let's make it cheaper. That's, I think we need to have
a fundamental issue is that the Indian financial institutions, banks, lenders, NBFCs, whatever you call them,
yes.
By any name, are not geared to do such level of microcredit on the kind of terms which, or are you seeing that changing?
No. If you look at the regional rural banks in Karnataka,
mm-hmm.
again, because these banks are not English-speaking banks,
mm-hmm.
that the English media does not cover, in the last 10 years, four banks have financed 300,000 households. 3 lakh households they have financed.
Right.
Right. On a commercial basis, at 12.5% in the priority sector lending,
mm-hmm.
they've done it. And then in many of the entrepreneurs, they finance. They finance between 5,000 to 20,000 rupees. For 36 months to 60 months.
Okay.
And depending on the cash flow, for example, paddy farmer, they'll have 5 year financing collections once a year. Peanut farmer twice a year. Because these banks are known for creating financing products for agriculture.
So they have a sense of the cash flow.
Yeah, so there are examples which we need to replicate in other parts, which will lead to scale up in a different manner.
In turning to products, because that's a point which you made, how do you see the product quality, product life cycle improving as, and what are you doing towards that? Are you responsive to your customer towards his need to have better products or the quality? I mean, this is almost a rough example of Mercedes-Benz having failed in India because they didn't introduce the cars which Indians wanted. Sorry, I'm taking a completely wrong example and wrong context, but it's like the customer saying the same thing, give me the quality which others receive.
Right.
But what are you doing? How are you making that affordable? How are you overcoming that challenge?
Sure. So the view we have taken from Energy is we've not sort of looked at just a single kind of a product. What we've tried to do is have a basket of products and let the customer choose. Let him choose what is the product he requires. Of course, and then when he wants a slightly more expensive product, then financing has to come in. And that's when look at how financing can come through either MFIs or banks. Banks is something it's still early days for us, but we've tried to do something with MFIs in the past. So with products, is again a range of products. Let the customer choose what he requires, but be extremely careful about the quality of the product. So I'm not going to choose a product A versus a product B because it's 100 rupees cheaper, which I would have done 2 years back. Now I'll probably go to the customer and they will always say it's too expensive. That's a normal tendency, even a urban customer does that. So I'm not going to get demotivated from hearing that, but understand how can I make it more affordable through financing for any particular product.
Can I?
Sure.
So, you know, we found this interesting. So we're involved with Sabre, with, mm-hmm. and there's, as you probably know, are placing one of probably the largest order of lanterns and cook stoves. And while helping finance that or look at that initiative, there was a lot of kind of, there was an RFP that was put out. We were looking at different vendors. We found that no particular vendor could actually fulfill what the need was. Mm-hmm. So we actually spent, we had our team go out and spend a lot of time on the ground, to your point, and trying to figure out what was really required. And even sort of a, this basket approach wasn't really working, because what we're hearing from them is they want a product that in the morning you can hang on your bicycle, go out to the fields, come back in the evening, you want to be able to, you know, have your children study, you want to be able to have, cause so that the, you know, use it as a torch, charge mobile phone. So it's almost like, you know, you had to almost create a one kind of a stop shop product that fits all the different needs. And we actually ended up having to work with one vendor to design something like this. So it's a very interesting concept. And price never came into the equation. It was really, this is what we need. If we get this product, we're willing to pay for it. Obviously, it has to be affordable within the realm of things. But there's a lot of, you know, I think to your point, Rishabh, people will kind of, you know, work on business plans and PowerPoints and all that, but the actual understanding on the ground, that's
in terms of the customer need.
The customer
need. So the same principles of marketing and segmentation, which are probably being applied for urban markets or for large consumer markets, will have to go out and apply to the smaller markets, and you will have to find similar customization solutions. You have to customize the solutions, or is what I hear.
Absolutely.
Okay. But may I turn to you, Afis? One question. Two points which we've heard today, and I'd like you to bring in what you think is, from the policy perspective, a reaction to this. One is, obviously, what we're hearing is you don't have enough people in this area. You don't have enough talent going into this area, the right kind of talent. The other, what we've heard today, as against normal complaints you hear in these forums, that we're short of money, we're short of the right kind of policy. What we're hearing is real practical issues here. We need people to come into this sector. We need right kind of talent to come in. We need right kind of customization of solution for the user. Now, is there anything on the horizon in India? Is there anything which can be done by the government, by HIV? We hear of our government talking about human resource development, building educational programs. I know it may not be the best solution involving government and everything, but is there anything on the horizon on the policy side which can, over a period of time, solve these issues? Do you see that happening?
Yeah. Before I get into the policy aspect of it, I just wanted to comment on the issues that have been raised. Our experience has been that, and we have been working on sort of photovoltaic systems as well as on cooking and highlighted, which is customization. So it is not merely a large menu of options that you require, but your ability to cater to specific needs that really determines the marketability and very closely linked is the issue of affordability. So if you can customize according to specific needs and requirements, you the affordability level immediately rises, and then financing sort of facilitates that. What that means, and this is our experience, has been that it doesn't mean that you need to have 20 or 200 products. What it means is that you need to have some core configuration in place around which you can develop and innovate.
Sure.
And you can innovate according to. So we have, I mean, the concept of solar charging station that we have sort of worked out emerged from that experience itself, where the issue of affordability, of people spending the amounts on kerosene, and looking at that, if they were to pay anywhere between 2 rupees to 5 rupees a day, it would be almost equivalent to what they would be spending in terms of buying kerosene on a monthly basis. So the affordability level gets built in into the customized requirement. Also, the concept emerged more from the point of view of that in scattered locations in certain specific areas, people wanted mobility with light. So again, it's not a new product that you need to work out. It's more about how you innovate. Mm-hmm. So the lantern has always been there. Lantern, home lighting systems. But what kind of innovation you could do in terms of bringing in a new element which is able to cater to the needs of the people? Also, I wanted to comment on what Hari said, and I agree that in terms of the urban atmosphere, in terms of possibly institutions that have been set up, it is becoming increasingly, and it is not related only to Selco, it is becoming increasingly difficult to attract younger generation into more long-term development issues. But on the other side, I would say that what is happening at the grassroots level and at the community level, and that is there is a whole bunch of youth there who are ready to innovate, who are ready to become entrepreneurs, and I'm sure Harish would have several such examples. We have our own experiences where women at the grassroots level, where youth at the grassroots level have actually come forward. And the challenge then for them becomes is this disconnect that there is no wherewithal and policy framework and apparatus which is there to catalyze and facilitate that process of making them into real entrepreneurs. And so and those challenges start from bottom up in terms of if they were to work out a business plan. I mean, we've been working on some of these setting up of these centers where they will be able to, yeah, where they'll be able to take a maintenance and sale, and there are a lot of people who are interested and who are willing to come forward, but they don't know where to start, where to go, what to do. And even if the ones that are sort of get trained, then there is a huge bottleneck in terms of financing. And that financing disconnect is again related to, yes, rural banks, Grameen banks are willing to finance. But the moment you go to some of these higher up and nationalized banks, it's a no-go for them. And microfinance, I would like to comment on that, is certainly not, I mean, apart from the issue that Harish raised in terms of requiring more long-term finance, for microfinance, I think one of the important issues is that the rate of interest is so high. And such expensive finance for poorest of the poor, I mean, I'm not talking of lighting, and if I talk of cooking, then you have to see from the point of view of the end user that they are dependent on something which is not costing them anything at all, either in terms of the construction of the chula or the cook stove, or in terms of the fuel that goes into it. And then you bring in a stove which is going to cost 1500, and on top of that you bring in microfinance which is going to cost anywhere between 25 to 40%, then it becomes completely unaffordable for those people. On the policy front, I think that a lot of this entrepreneurship and a lot of these initiatives are happening in spite of the policy issues. I mean, policy of course would facilitate the process, would expedite a lot of things, but I don't think it is policy or regulation that is holding this back. Of course, that could facilitate the process. And one of the areas in terms of regulation that requires attention, and that is something that we focused on in this Life of Billion Lives program, is to look at the issue of quality. Because benchmarking of specifications and quality issues is a huge concern. I mean, we've had things in Bihar, in Jharkhand, where a lot of spurious stuff, particularly on solar lighting, went around and completely spoiled the market. And it became difficult for people who were investing in quality, who were investing in terms of taking things forward. So that is one area that requires attention. And Government of India is focusing on that. We do have some certification systems, but it is more at a very, very macro level. You require a much more decentralized access to such setups in terms of benchmarking, in terms of standardization, in terms of looking at all those quality issues. This becomes critically important in cook stove sector, where anything and everything starting from 15% thermal efficiency up to 40% thermal efficiency is classified as improved cook stove. Yeah. And that 15% thermal efficiency, yeah, in 2 months of usage becomes much worse than the traditional stove that people have been using. It's completely unregulated. I can come up with a stove, set up a company and say, I'm into the improved cook stove business. It requires enormous amount of standardization, regulation, and that is again, Government of India is focusing on this. I've been involved with the ministry in this process. But I think there is a lot of work that needs to be done and a lot of information that needs to come up from bottom up. Finally, on the policy side, I think for off-grid solutions, largely it is in terms of having a more open-ended framework, whether it is to do with benchmarking, whether it is to do with regulation in terms of cost. Because what has really worked is that there are inherent things that are happening. For instance, there is a lot of proliferation of diesel gensets in rural areas. And these people are charging a hefty amount. And so you don't require cost regulations at the grassroots level. You don't require regulatory commissions to come into place. In fact, they would spoil the scenario. A lot of this is highly competitive because of the low paying capacities. So, but important element in all this is how quality is provided, how standards are maintained, and how benchmarking is undertaken.
Thank you. That's a very comprehensive answer. In your answer, you've landed raising up a couple of issues, which is very familiar territory, which is lack of institutional support for any of these mechanisms, which is, and I don't mean institutional support as in large government departments, as you said, we don't need commissions. But if I ask you to come in here, IFC has a developmental agenda. While you are a private equity investor like any other, but you too have a developmental agenda. What we've seen is many of the countries support, and this is a larger question than just simply off-grid, many countries have very strong institutional mechanisms to support innovation. And such a mechanism could go a long way in terms of supporting innovation in off-grid or rural sector. We in India seem to be missing that mechanism, which probably leads back to the point that that entrepreneurs such as Harish have to then walk into the nearest private equity fund to talk business, which they find is not conducive to them. The kind of institutional support needed to support such ventures from a financing perspective is missing. What's your view on that? What do we need in this country to really go out and support these smaller social ventures? Do we need some kind of incubators? And I think broadly is that is what Afiz has alluded to, that we don't have that support system. What's your view on that?
Sure. So I think, looking at off-grid rural electrification is extremely important to us. And we've been trying to figure out how IFC can play in this market broadly. The big issue that's come up is, I think, the size of funding that's required.
Right.
Finding a broader platform that can really address a market where, based on our internal costs and so forth, to actually provide financing has been a bit challenging. So you're right, I think there's an in-between step that's required. And whether that's angel funding, whether that's some kind of an incubator to allow some of these entrepreneurs to grow companies and sort of also get them ready to your point of being able to then sit and talk to an equity investor. And we're somewhat different, so we wear sort of multiple hats. And so we're looking at a couple of ways to address this, because this again is very important to us and seeing how we can get an active here. So the Lighting India program is going to be one step towards that. We're working on a number of initiatives, including working with the government and MNRE on standard setting, looking at providing technical assistance to a number of companies, looking at overall market, figuring out what types of initiatives we can get involved with to help the overall market, including access to finance, and what types of financial structures can be created. And where IFC can play a role perhaps as on the back end.
Right.
One of the issues around that, unfortunately, is in India, because of some of the regulations, you can't provide sort of risk guarantees. So there's because we're a foreign investor. So there's challenges around that. We're still trying to work through some of those issues.
Which has been a challenge across sectors.
Correct.
You've tried to do it in other areas as well, not only in off-grid, but other areas as well, and has been a challenge.
Exactly.
But do you see any breakthroughs happening there? Do you see any newer structures emerging on the horizon which you think will be more supportive of this sector?
So I think, one of the things we're trying to do is, again, look at a wholesale approach. So if that's working through banks, which we're trying to do, and it's broader renewable financing, but this could be one area that they look at. We're looking at investing in an incubator, a clean tech incubator right now. So again, which can work with these younger entrepreneurs or smaller kind of companies and help grow and then allow for mainstream IFC financing at that point. So we're definitely targeting, we haven't found the right model, and part of the issue is the scalability.
Right.
Because you need companies to be large enough to access the type of the size of financing that
size
they're doing. And unfortunately, because of a number of issues, but a lot of which have been discussed over here, we haven't found too many at that point.
Okay. Andy, may I ask you to come in here and, you know, step back and give all of us here what you've heard is typically very, very Indian problems. Now, you've been operating outside India. You've been in Southeast Asia, other parts of the world. Do you see this as the normal problems in this stage of life cycle we are in? Or do you think it's very different to what you've seen other places?
Yeah, I would say so. I start making my experience in Laos, and so we can use Laos as an example, but I see also the same problems, the same issue in many other parts of the world. For example, Mozambique, Sierra Leone, Liberia, all around is the same one. And this is, I think, I don't know, I have to say, I don't know so much about India, what is going on in India. But the main problem is that people in these other countries, what I mentioned, is living really far from each other.
Mm-hmm.
So also, let's use Laos as an example. We don't have established a financial sector so far. We don't have any microfinancing here. Also, from my experience, I have to say that I think microfinancing is the wrong vehicle for energy, for the basic energy. We're talking here, provide energy to the poorest of the poorest, basic energy, what is good enough for improving their individual living condition, but nothing for generate more income. So most of the time is the problem that the people can't, I think in general, is the wrong way that people in the field should shoulder these financial burdens on their shoulder. This means they have to pay back the loans, they have to pay back the interest for this. They have no chance to generate additional income with this, how they should do this. So I think we have to come up with new mechanisms, how to provide energy to these people in the field. Our way forward is here that we're doing this the same as people in urban areas. Nobody of us is also buying a piece of the grid line. We're always paying the fee to the utility. Why not transforming this model also to remote areas? So here we're coming up, and this is our main strategy in all our different activities, what we're doing, providing water, drinking water, clean drinking water, providing lights, providing energy to the field, is people in the field should just pay only for the service. This means the next point is then, where comes the money for this?
Mm.
So, and I was really naive in the first years when I started the business. I was always thinking, I can manage this. I can create commercial viable business in the same time affordable for the end user. And this doesn't work. This is my lesson learned from the last 15 years. This will never work. When someone comes today and say, we can create micro business here, what is commercial also viable? It can't work at all. So this brings me to the last years. The only way to solve this, to provide something to the people in remote areas, is a PPP. This could mean private-public partnership, or we see it more and more in the last years, is also private-private partnership. But we need to manage this. We have to come up that we need the initial funding for the material has to be paid from outside. We know this from all around the world, in the Midwest, in the US, in Australia, in Europe, everywhere where the grid is extended is heavily subsidies involved. Why not also, where's the subsidies in remote areas? Nowhere we see it. Always the public side comes and, hey, show us how you can do this, how you can manage this alone. The point to IFC, I have long, many years experience with all these public donors, from the World Bank, from the IFC, whatever. Here's the problem that Harris also mentioned. Who really in the field, these young entrepreneurs, who is able really to provide a business plan? When this financial organization coming in and doing the due diligence, who is really enabled here for doing this? Then we hear always so much money around in the world, so much money is available. Since now the US pension funds also focusing on the off-grid market, huge amounts of money. Last time I joined this ADB Access to Energy, they're all talking about so much money. But there's a big gap from these big sharks who are providing the money down to the ground. Before this money reaches the ground, we see the big bag of money here. Before it reaches a really small little bag of money. So how come we know, we heard this in the session before, corruption with local governments. This is an issue all around the world. We see it everywhere. But the other very important point is also this transaction cost from all these IFC, World Bank, ADB, KfW guys, before they can really manage something, these people, we all in the field, these social entrepreneurs, we can't, what should we do with 10, 15, 20 million dollars? We need a small amount. These guys saying, sorry guys, it's too small, we can't do this. You're talking about local banks, working with local banks. In India, it's maybe working, but in other parts of the world, like Laos, where we don't have established a financial sector so far, with whom would you like to work there? So this is a problem here on the transition, bringing the big money to the ground to the social entrepreneurs. This is the biggest problem that I see so far. One part, the other part is really we have, from our side, we have to change the whole mechanism and not selling, selling the hardware. We see it in Africa with all these companies who are focusing on affordable products, what means cheap products, 600 rupin solar lamp. What does it mean? This lamp is good for 6 months, for 8 months, for 10 months. Then this plastic junk is dumping around the village. The batteries, what happens with the batteries? No replacement, no recycling is in place so far. So the environmental is a huge impact for the environment. Why not coming up with a new business model and saying, we have a micro-enterprise, we have a micro-entrepreneur in the village, this guy is providing maintenance, everything, he is selling the service, and people paying according to this, to their need and what they can afford to pay. So this, I think, is the most more innovative way to do it in the future.
Andy, I'm going to come back to you, but Pravin, you have done one such deal, which is with Husk Power. There's this company in India, and that is the company has been working on this principle of providing it as a service rather than. So, what's your experience been with them? How successful have they been? You funded that company. How do you see growth of that particular? And I will return to Harish and Vinay after that in terms of their understanding of providing it providing access as a service rather than as a product. What's your view on that?
Sure. So before I just address Andy's point, I think you're totally right. And I think that's part of the issue is there's pools of money available, but then from, you know, how does that reach the end consumer of that capital? And part of it is finding that platform. Because, for example, for IFC, as I mentioned in the opening, we're investing about $1 billion into South Asia. For us to start working on very small, you know, even sub $1 million, you know, and for a lot of these companies, they need a couple of $100,000. To actually work the processing charge, the opportunity cost of being able to work on, you know, actually put this level of capital out, it's a challenge. So we need to find that kind of intermediary and figure out what's the right platform. Is it a company that gets set up that will then turn and sort of become its own sort of a financing institution that focuses on rural electrification? Perhaps. We haven't seen that yet, but that's one of the alternatives. Are there other kind of in between? I think it's a little easier for the World Bank, where you can work with not-for-profits, you can work with other government institutions to provide that access to the end consumer. But it's definitely a challenge. And that's why we're looking at more of a facility approach, because that's the only way we can really work on this. Through the advisory program, if there's ways to access, to provide kind of pooled capital that banks can draw on, that consumers can draw on, again, within working within the regulatory framework in India, which is in itself a challenge based on how you put these sort of financing structures in place. But it's definitely something we're trying to address, and it's an important problem to do that. Going back to the experience with Husk, I mean, that's exactly the approach that they sort of have in terms of providing a service to consumers. And in this case, these are villagers in Bihar. These are sort of the poorest of the poor, won't see the grid for the next 50 years. So for us, it was a very important investment for us. Small, it was $350,000, the investment that we made. And I think, you know, there's been a lot of lessons learned, and we're trying to support them beyond the capital with some of the advisory services that we have, mm-hmm. including helping set up some training initiatives for their workforce as well, which is an important point there. I think they've done a great job in terms of trying to fine-tune the business model, but because that really becomes the issue at the end. I mean, you're looking at credit, looking at trying to figure out how to provide the power, but making sure that you're able to get paid for it. So they've drawn on a number of experiences from the mobile sectors, kind of a prepaid approach, a number of other sort of operational things that have come up.
Their scaling up experience, have they been? I believe they have 80 villages covered now.
Correct.
So that's Andy, to say that, yes, we are experimenting with this in India.
Yeah, but then let me ask, my experience with public organization like the World Bank or IFC is also, or with developing banks from Europe, with the FMO from the Netherlands or Triodos or whoever. Yeah. The point is, what is the return of investment here? We're dealing with people who have no funds, almost no funds available in the field. So these guys are always from the public side or from the banking side always coming back and saying, hey, come on, guys, when the ROI, the return of investment, is longer than 10 years, we can't make it. So this is really an issue for our business projection also. What can we do? We have to provide affordable energy service to these people. We knowing also that these guys 3 months before the next harvest, they're running out of money. So this is also, we have experimented with these models. We sold out in the 10 years ago, we rented out solar home systems. People have to pay a monthly fee for it. So 3 months, 4 months before harvest, they were not able to pay us. So we had big problems with the cash flow for our side. So this is, I think, when my experience, return of investment longer than 7 years, nobody is really willing to come in.
And I guess the point is, how do you bridge that gap?
So how to bridge this gap? Exactly.
And what we look at is also concessional financing. Mm. So in cases, and you know, to the point, Husk actually didn't require it. So this is interesting. Even though you're providing power to villages in Bihar, they figure out a model that's sustainable on its own. There's no kind of, subsidies are, MNRE has announced subsidies, they haven't managed to access it yet, but they're looking at providing this service and getting paid for it and providing and building up a business around that without this. But then aside, I think there's the other kind of business models where concessional finance can help bridge the gap, get lenders comfortable, get equity holders comfortable, and then that's one option. The other option is then going down the subsidy route, which, as we know, is not always the most successful route to follow, but that's another. So whether you bring in governments, whether you bring in concessional finance, there has to be something in to bridge that gap in our cases, because the returns to a typical private equity investor will not be there.
Well, can I just quickly turn the conversation around? You've heard Andy talk about his experience with turning this whole thing into a service rather than a product. You've heard Brian make some comments on it. What's your experience? Is this feasible in India? Or does it stress your balance sheets to a point you're not able to raise access money, and it stresses your balance sheets to a point that it's not feasible? What's your experience with this? Have you tried?
Thing is that it's, in India, we have to understand we actually work on easier ecosystems than what Andy works in.
Mm-hmm.
We have 40,000 banks in the rural areas. Mm-hmm. 40,000. No other developing country has that banking system. Right. The service model, we do a lot of service models. Right. Like people ask us, I don't want a light. I don't want solar light. I want 4 hours of lighting.
Right.
Right. That's a difference. I just want to pay for it. So here you can actually create small guarantee mechanisms in the bank, which actually provides the financing to the entrepreneur who delivers this light. So it's not on my balance sheet, unlike Andy's. So Andy has to come for more cash flows because that's no. But the transaction cost for us to convince the banker, to convince the entrepreneur, to create the ecosystem,
right,
it's where my rate of return actually goes down. Mm-hmm. It's not that I'm losing money on the direct sale, but I'm losing money. It's just like a lot of these.
It takes you longer to make the sale.
Yeah, that's many of the investors have to think that it's like all want to invest in Google without understanding the internet does not exist.
Mm-hmm.
We are building Google and internet together.
Right.
Right. Who pays for the cost of paying of developing the internet? Google did not pay the cost of internet. It succeeded, made money on it. We have to develop the internet. Who pays for it? And that's why the rate of return is lower. That ecosystem does not exist. And we need to. And that's where I think when private equity funds, I'm very afraid of private equity funds who does not have a practitioners on their side.
Mm-hmm.
You have MBAs on that side. You need a practice. You talk about incentives and subsidies. I work in Bangalore, right? My IT industry does not pay income tax. I make profit, I pay 30% tax. Is that not subsidy to the IT industry? When our clients buy solar, they are avoiding kerosene, which is imported and subsidized,
mm-hmm,
and they pay 7% tax on solar.
There was some
and that's
subsidies.
The ecosystem we work on.
Could be another session.
Subsidy. You're not in a playing field with the IT industry.
Level playing.
Right. So I think we need to look at the social field very differently.
On this controversial issue, I think I'll throw it open to the audience. Please feel free to ask questions. Not just Harish on his controversial ideas, but anybody. Is there a mic or something?
Adish, I have a question for you on the distribution part. You said that you're primarily existing in Karnataka and Gujarat. You've been around this industry for long enough. What challenges, how come you haven't gone to other power-starved states?
There are 44 million people in Karnataka. It'll take me my lifetime to actually look at Karnataka, frankly. And what we said was, let's use our 17 years of experience to go deeper and deeper into the startup, the economic startup. That itself is scalability. In the sense, you reach more number of people. Because we are an open source private company, we want other youngsters to come up and take what we have done in 17 years. Don't go through the pains that we have gone through in 17 years. You can actually do it, and that's our scalar model, is how do we replicate many of our processes through entrepreneurs like Vinay, or through processes that we have developed through a Grameen bank and developed that in UP with a financial institution. So it's either through an entrepreneur or through a banking institution. And that's what we said, let's keep our 17 years of experience. Today, see, average household earnings is 2,000 to 3,000 rupees. Our challenge in 2014 is 20% of our clients should be earning. We have created solutions for people who earn 1,000 rupees or less in the month. So we would use our 17 years of experience to create those sustainable business models that others can replicate. And that's been our focus, very clear.
So you're looking at tying up with partners?
Or incubating and inspiring. What we've been criticizing, that the young are not coming. Now we put up a challenge that, Are we doing our job to encourage youngsters to come in or not?
I think I'll just like to come in here. So I'll just reiterate on what Harish was saying. So when Harish says he doesn't believe in scale, the first comment that he made, I think that's absolutely wrong. What he's done to us is, look at how Selco has done, grown. He's accessible to us anytime. So is the top management of Selco. And if I try to go to a similar startup in the same space, a lot of them have a lot of the confidential data up their sleeves, which they don't want to talk off, share resources. But here is Selco that's looking at how Selco can grow across India. So it's probably not doing it itself, but it's giving enough resources, giving enough information, giving enough knowledge, making these gaps, connecting these gaps for other enterprises to see how they can scale up. So maybe we're not doing everything that Selco does. We're trying to do our own thing along with it. But also see, we also have Selco with us to see how we can scale up in the way Selco is done, or do the work that, and share the information, learn from all their experiences, and not have to reinvent the wheel again.
Also, in terms of scaling up, I think that a lot of these things become more of terminology which is sort of used over and over again without getting deep into it. Scalability in off-grid decentralized solutions is not in terms of I've done something in this area and it has succeeded here, let me now scale it up to the entire country. It doesn't work. I mean, all of us who've been working at the grassroots level know that very well. Selco has done something in Karnataka. It has the process, the evolution, the customization of it has taken years to develop. Part of it, the learnings would be applicable to if something started off in Bihar or in Jharkhand, but it would need to be a different kind of scaling. It would be a different kind of intervention that is required. Decentralized requirements, and when you go into other areas of access to energy, again, if you take cooking, then it's highly decentralized, very customized. So scalability, I think, needs to be talked more in terms of scaling the macro learnings that we get, and seeing that those learnings are applied in terms of all the replication and customization that takes place in other places. So one size fits all is not going to work in access to energy, not even in rural lighting. End users are different. So the moment you get into the service aspect, you are getting into a totally different, where electricity is required, where
power is required, what is the end use, what kind of technology configuration. So I think we need to be a little cautious when we talk about scalability. And again, taking the example of NABL, we are focusing more on looking at business models, looking at the ecosystem infrastructure, rather than looking at numbers. Though, of course, for strategic purposes, it is good to call it lighting a billion lives, but it doesn't mean that you sort of go out and do this thing all across the globe.
And you have...
I would not fully agree on your comment. I think from our experience, what we're doing, transforming our... We used Lauma as a test lab. Laos is a country with 6 million people. When I heard Harris is working in a small area in India with 44 million, is a little model here. So it's not so important how high are the initial costs are. But our experience that we bring this model, what we tested, what we proved in Laos, brought it to a Muslim country, to Afghanistan, for example, it works perfectly. We brought it to East Africa, to Uganda, and also to Tanzania. Now we see it works also in the Pacific. Sure, we know there's cultural difference, geographical difference. We have to modify it according to the regional needs. But more or less, coming up with this service model, combined with the first quality product here, what really ensures a long life operation, so far our experience is really perfect, that we can see it works also in different areas of the world with different cultural and geographical background.
I agree, so long as you're willing to innovate and customize according to the needs.
But also it requires an understanding and an involvement of a third party. If it's a public side, if it's a global public donor, or is it a global private player like HP or Coca-Cola or whatever, who see it as involved as part of their internal CSR strategy. This is what also what we have to focus now in these days is becoming more and more up, that global players from the private side, everybody, if Toyota or Mercedes or whoever, they all have their CSR strategy. And they are really looking for partners at the ground level. So this is also a change where we think it's much more, looks more so successful than waiting for another decade and another decade for the public side. Because the public side is also a general problem that this language from the public side is very often totally different from the language of the private side. So this to fill these gaps is sometimes very difficult, you would agree.
Very interesting observation in terms of accessing a pocket of investors we never talked about, which is corporate CSR, which, by the way, is increasing. If you look at these dollars they have available to do what they hope, I don't know how much of it actually translates down, because at the end of their own corporate CSR, there are certain objectives they have. But there surely will be some pockets available for the kind of work you all sitting in this room want to do.
And this is a difference. They are not focusing anymore to donate a school roof somewhere.
Right.
And they really want long-term, they focus on sustainability. But for this, they need also reliable, trustful partners in the field.
Right. I don't know if you can brand some of these as Coca-Cola lights, but it's definitely worth a shot.
What's interesting is that it sounds like the message coming out is, you know, this is not really a return play for typical private equity funds and venture capital funds.
Wow, you're washing your hands off already.
That's the point. So if I have an entrepreneur sitting saying, I'm going to give you, you know, 20-30% IRR.
Let's take it to the IFCCS.
Bring it back to the standard.
All right. Are there any more questions? Yeah.
Hi, my name is Paksan and I'm from Dasra. And my question is mainly towards Pawan, Harish, and Vinay. So we have organizations such as Unlimited, which are basically incubation organizations. And then my organization is basically in the business of working with slightly mature nonprofits and social businesses and help direct funding towards them and give them assistance to scale, basically. And we have seen this working in education, healthcare, etc. What do you think is the role of organizations such as Unlimited and Dasra within the energy sector, and how do you see that growing?
So I think that there's a very important role, and then when we talked about bridging the gap earlier, I think this is where you know, in a lot of cases, even some of the companies we're working with also set up not-for-profit kind of companies along Section 25 companies alongside them to provide awareness, to kind of feedback to kind of the institutional community on what how they should be looking at this, how to sort of get more of that grassroots sort of information up. So I think there's a very important role, and we're you know, happy to engage in these initiatives.
Thank you.
Okay. So we've been part of some of these incubation initiatives. Some of my colleagues, Piyush and Ekta, have actively engaged themselves in these initiatives. They're good. From my perspective, I look at them as a good way to network, get to know other enterprises more than anything else. I think the peer learning is the most beneficial of anything. I think when we talk about giving access to invest, talking to investors, I think you'll find them any which ways. It's more peer learning, and it's the experiences you share on the field. I think that's most valuable.
I would add is that it's good to a certain part, but I think you also need to do a little bit of more ragging, in a sense that it's one is the knowledge, but you need. I think groups like Dasra Unlimited should tie up with enterprises at the ground level, where you have certain graduates who graduate from what, go and slog it out with 3 months with that particular grassroots level on the ground as a de facto employee. Until he does not get the day-to-day tension of waking up at 3 o'clock in the morning because his manager in the local office is going to kill him, I think that other classroom training does not gel. I think that's where it's a hard, see, for example, when his brother came in, we basically sent out telling them, he worked for a month and a half in a rural area, and our manager would send him to the bank, and the manager would call the bank and say, whatever he says, say no. And you frustrate the guy so much that does he have the capability to handle that frustration? I think that real life experience, not 1 month, not Saturday, Sundays, not volunteerism, it's hardcore 3 months or 4 months. I mean, I would like it 1 year, but people don't have the time nowadays, but it's 3 months regularly.
Sure, Harish, you're not frightening away the prospective people by telling them these stories.
I'm actually attracting only the serious ones.
Fair point.
So I understand that the incubation process of maybe a 3 months is not useful, but do you think that capacity building over, say, around 200 days for 3 years
they should
would help?
They should have an internship in an existing hardcore organization which is based in the grassroots level. Like, suppose you have internships of nurses or doctors in an existing hospital where they really see an operation happening, right? And I think it's that where they need to spend time. Yeah.
The organizers, do we have time? There's one more question.
My name is Royston from Grameen Capital, and our job is to connect capital with the bottom of the pyramid. One of the questions that I had, particularly maybe Harish or anyone else on the panel could jump in, and disclaimer up front, like all investment bankers, I've come in late into the panel, so if you've answered this before or addressed this, then please tell me and I won't waste your time. But have you addressed the point of carbon credits and finding ways to really provide alternative streams of revenue? Because I hear from the discussions that you can't attract mainstream capital because you know, the return process is too elongated and some of those. But have you looked at alternative streams of revenue, and does carbon credits play any role, or are we just clutching at straws? Both of you, Harish and the gentleman.
Both of you, Anvil.
Okay. So we're doing this since many years. We have some carbon experts in-house. And so when we're talking about base of the pyramid people, so we know, let's use this example of solar lantern. This is a basic one. So our calculations, and we really went deep into a village, let's say 50 charging stations. We don't have the size, I have to say. We don't have the same size like in India, a typical Indian village. But let's say 100 lanterns in a village can save around 10 tons per year. So 10 tons, the carbon brokers, these carbon companies around the world, they are not interested at all to look into it, if it's not more than 20,000 tons per year. So this is absolutely ridiculous. The only way forward is to scale it up internally, that we have one solar charging station in one village in one district, 10 districts in one province, 10 provinces in one country, and using the same model, since we do in a service model, this is a way forward. We are the owner of the carbons. When we can do this, when we can scale it up also to five different continents. And, this makes sense. Then we have a huge potential, and this is really a sexy opportunity. Providing the poorest with lights and the poorest of the poorest in the world, also contributing to the CO2 emission reduction. This is a way forward, but focus really on using this as additional finance in the field, in remote areas, is almost ridiculous. We checked it also with pico hydropower, with micro hydropower, with village hybrid grids. This amount of carbons, what we can save here, makes really no sense. Nobody is really interested to buy these tons here. So the carbon financing opportunity works for many sectors, for the cement industry, for it's not clarified so far what happens after 2012 with the big hydro dams, but for rural electrification in the field, forget it.
We have a slightly different experience around this in India, but Hafiz, would you guys like to
back? I'll go for a little take. You can answer that, because I have a little. I'm very hesitant to see a business plan which is based on carbon offset. Yeah. And it has to be operationally profitable, sustainable economically, socially, and environmentally. A carbon offset is always a bonus. In a sense, irrespective of a small amount, what Andy says, or a large amount of a cement industry, it's a bonus. It's somewhere, I think for our industry, if there's a carbon offset, use it for capacity building, which nobody else gives you money for, rather than spending your heavy equity. But I'm always very nervous when a business plan is built on carbon offsets. I think that's, it's not sustainable on the long term. You're not creating a it's all good business on the ground level, and that's my take on the CO2s. Yes, definitely it has benefited. I mean, for example, because we have a number of systems, but what we have used those money is not for shoring up the bottom line. The money that we have used, for example, if there are very poor families who are earning 1600 rupees, but the bank says, boss, there's no credit evaluation, they only have two pats and pound. What we do is then we negotiate with the bank and said, okay, for an 8,000 rupee loan, what's the guarantee you want? They said 20%. We would use carbon offset money to put that guarantee of 20% and leverage that 20% to unlock local capital 1:5. That's where we basically work on the additionality of the... And the other is branding, like once Pink Floyd bought from us.
So just to add, banks will not take carbon credits as security itself. So he's right, you'll have to convert it. You take the cash which is generated from that and provide that as security. Hafiz, you wanted to say something to this.
No, I just wanted to add to this. I think, carbon credit, carbon finance becomes more important from the point of view of showing intent rather than in terms of actually benefiting financially, either at the end user end or the manufacturer's end. And there are a lot of challenges. The challenge of aggregation itself is huge. Setups such as Selco may achieve some of it, but smaller enterprises and entrepreneurs, the transaction costs involved, all the instruments involved in order to really benefit from it in financial terms is very minimal. So I think it is more in terms of leveraging and more in terms of branding, so that you can get some visibility in terms of the intent and focus on the clean part.
Yeah. I just add one quick sentence to it. I think there's been a lot of noble thought behind carbon, which is programmatic carbon, VERs, gold, gilt-edged carbon. But I think it's not really worked. Apart from one project in Mexico, which could collate carbon from bulb users, we haven't really seen programmatic carbon take off, number one. Number two, in today's environment, where carbon is trading at whatever price it's trading at today, does it make sense for an entrepreneur to spend energy, money on that? Yes, certainly, if it went up to the theoretical price of $30, you'd probably find all of us being very interested suddenly to go after that carbon. But till that happens, I think this is a market-driven mechanism. Until it reaches the right price, you probably will find people not very excited about it. At least in India, I've seen the excitement die down. So, That's probably a comment. I think the organizers are asking us to close the event. You're free to interact with all of these gentlemen of the podium. So thank you very much.
Thank you.
Can I ask you to ask a question bilaterally to whosoever wanted to reach out to? And so we'll just close it here.
Just give thank us 1 minute.
Sure.
Thank you everyone for being part of the session. We just have some small tokens for our speakers, which I'd like to hand out.
It looks like a photograph.
Of course.
Thank you so much. Yeah. Okay.
So you wanted different photographs. We could trade them. We can switch.